Okay. Well, okay. Now we're going to do Aunt Barb's Magic Oven episode, chapter number 24. I feel kind of bad though if I seem a little glum. I just knocked out a video. In fact, I am. It's posted just ahead of this one in the progression. It's only about 2 minutes long, where I in the middle of getting started. I was explaining. Before I got started on reading the chapter 24, I realized that it was raining nicely out, and I took the camera off the holder, and went to the window to get a photo, to get a little bit of a video of the river, and it didn't seem like it was coming in very well, but it came in nicely enough, so I but I didn't think it was. So I figured, oh, this one's a goof up. And then I started, well, I said, well, heck, I'll just keep pushing and read the story. I got to reading the story. I made a mistake with the very first reading, the very first sentence. And I said, okay, that's it. We're going to take two. And so this is take two. But now, having looked at it, I think it would have been funny. So I feel kind of like I missed a chance. Anyway, the original, the 2 minute short take is available. You can look at it. Maybe in due time I'll watch that one be the big hit. Yeah. And well, anyway, so now I've got the Aunt Barb thing. We're going to read it, and that's that. Aunt Barb's magic oven, the ball, the wheelbarrow, and the olives start to roll. Well, the ball was rolling. Uncle Bill and my father were setting up a beer keg and the at the outdoor and the outdoor cocktail lounge. They were both testing each other on drink recipes and subtle nuances, like did it really make a difference whether a martini should be shaken or stirred? Big debate between the two of them. They both agreed that that it's best to just drink a martini and ask for another. Pope John Paul was nearby and said how he really preferred an olive in his martini, and said how those little onions just didn't, well, they just didn't cut it. John Paul was busy setting up a very large drum of holy water. He said he'd be needing that holy water pretty soon. Then he asked my father to make him a martini with, one olive for that drink. The Pope then said that if he ordered a second drink, if he did, he should have two olives, and so forth and so on. He kidded in that way he could keep count. All right. Aunt Barb and her sisters were in the kitchen running around like bees in a hive. Grandma was in there too. Even if they still had their wings and legs, the turkeys couldn't have flown or run around any better than they were moving in that kitchen at the moment. The Aunt Alice would grab a platter out of the cabinet, stick a turkey on it. It would look like it was it would look like she was running out of platters when bingo, 10 more. 10 more would appear. 10 more platters would appear on the cabinet shelf. Funny too, but once the turkeys were on the platter, they somehow carved themselves. Odd also was the fact that a 55-gallon drum of turkey gravy just appeared on Barb and Bill's back porch. The guys in my girl cousins' lives, be they boyfriend, fiance, or husband, hefted that 55-gallon drum of turkey gravy around to the front yard and set it up on a drum rack. Yeah, like in the gas stations. Yeah. Okay. The drum was nice and hot too. Once they did that, my mom got them to put the stuffing into real clean wheelbarrows, well, practically new. And take them out to the sidewalk. Up and down Carson Avenue, the neighbors were doing all they could as well. Chairs, benches, recliners, wheelchairs, card tables, dining tables, and even more wheelbarrows were for the mashed potatoes came out of basements, attics, and garages. Some of the younger kids went into the cemetery with Billy and gathered the flowers off the graves and brought them to the tables for centerpieces. President Reagan got the Secret Service guys to move a few sofas out onto the lawns. Some of the agents also helped with the speaker stand, you know, for the TV broadcast. That was put under a nice elm tree for the shade. Gabe came over and asked the guys, though, if they would, if they could move it just a bit so that at least a bit of the sunlight would hit the stand and there'd be a clear shot up to the sky. The guys were happy to help. The stand was moved into better sunlight in no time at all. You know, those agents are pretty tough. Me, I felt that I should go sit over on the swing set and write some notes for my address to the world. I was told that I had 15 minutes to airtime. The mobile broadcast link truck and its crew just pulled off the main highway and came down the street, and they'd been setting up. I had maybe two notes jotted down in my worst handwriting ever. The notes were impossible to read. Okay, friends. Well, that's, again, number 24. We'll be doing 25 soon enough. All right? Okay. Gee, I feel, well, no, that'll do for now. Maybe I'll do a when the weather clears up a little, maybe we'll do a little report about the river in the back there, the Musconetcong, getting kind of wacky. Although it's certainly, we're safe up here. We're about, gosh, we're about 25 feet above the river. So, yeah, we're okay. If that river goes up 25 feet, oh, yeah, I've seen it do 5 feet. Yeah, and that's pretty hairy. Oh, yeah. But again, just, water just goes by below. Okay. Anyway, so that's a wrap. We'll catch you later. Have a ball. We'll see you. God bless.